On the right, you see a TouchGFX demo. On the left, the same demo built with LVGL. The user interface is very simple. Just a button to increment a counter and navigation between two screens. But it's all you need to know to get started. Hello, thinking about using an LCD touchscreen in your next project? Or maybe switching to a new graphics library? If so, this two-part video is for you. I'll give you a quick overview of both libraries so you can understand how they work without having to install the tools or configure hardware yourself. And if you ever wanted a custom LCD, check out my other video on how to make your own. Now, both LVGL and TouchGFX let you build similar user interfaces, but their approaches are a bit different. LVGL renders UI elements programmatically at runtime, drawing shapes, gradients, and effects pixel by pixel. In contrast, TouchGFX relies more on pre-rendered image assets stored in memory, which are displayed directly on screen. So let's see what I'm using in those demos. The first one is based on an STM32 discovery board. It comes with an integrated 4-inch display and plenty of built-in peripherals. On this board, I'll be showing you how to implement TouchGFX, the graphics library from STMicroelectronics. The second setup uses a Nucleo board paired with a separate 3.5-inch LCD that is commonly available online at a low cost. For this one, I'll be using LVGL along with EStudio for UI design. Also, this isn't a performance comparison between the two setups. They don't have the same specs, so any direct benchmark would be unfair. The F469 is more powerful and the graphics accelerator is fully enabled. The goal of this presentation is to walk you through a few key steps in the implementation process, not to compare the two systems side by side. So let's start with a short introduction to TouchGFX Designer. Let's begin by creating a new project based on the demo board. First, we change the orientation of the screen to portrait and then rename the default screen to home. We set the background using an image widget. TouchGFX provides nice preset images, but of course you can also import your own background. For example, you can design it using Inkscape. We can draw a rectangle, remove the stroke, and set its dimensions to the size of the LCD display in pixels. We can overlay two other rectangles of the same size with partially transparent color gradients to give it a nicer look. We can export this stack as a PNG file and import it into the local images section in TouchGFX. Then we can assign it as our screen's background. Next, we can add a text area, change the color to white, and set the font size to large. We want it to be a dynamic text at runtime, so we write the keyword value and use a wildcard buffer with an initial value of 0. Then we can add two buttons. We select a rounded icon button preset and use a settings icon from the materials library. For the second button, we use the add icon and keep the default button preset. Then we can create a second screen, name it settings, and apply the same background image. On this screen, we place one more button for navigation and this time use the home icon. We can add a text area. If your application supports only one language, you can type the text using the properties side panel. But if you want multilingual support, you can go to the text page and add a new language and the translated text. Under the typography tab, you can also define new fonts to use in your application. There are many fonts available to choose from, but if you want another one, you can add it to the application. For that, you need to place the font file you want in the fonts folder of your application. Then, after restarting the designer, it will appear in the list of available fonts. To demonstrate this, we download the Roboto Bold font from Google Fonts library and define a size of 180 for our application. Then we can apply it to our counter label. Next, we can name the different buttons and add new interactions for the buttons in the Interaction tab. For the navigation buttons, we set the trigger event as button clicked, the action to change screen, and the transition type. For the increase button, we set the action to call new virtual function. Then I can run the simulator to test the screen navigation. We see that the application behaves as we expect. We can navigate the pages and it doesn't increment the counter, as we haven't defined the body for the virtual function yet. We can now switch to STM32 Cube IDE and implement the logic behind the increase counter function. First, we import into our workspace the project which was created by TouchGFX Designer. In the header file of the home screen, we define the function prototype increment counter, an update function for the graphical elements, and an integer variable named counter. Then, in the CPP file, we can implement both functions. The update function is responsible for refreshing the UI elements. It is needed because, for example, you need to update the displayed text after increasing the counter, but you also need to refresh it after the screen is loaded. Otherwise, when you navigate between screens, if they are not refreshed, they are reloaded with the default value. Finally, we can upload the firmware to the target board. We see the counter increment as we press the button, and that we can navigate between the home and settings screens. So that's it for TouchGFX. Don't miss part 2, where I dive into LVGL using the second setup.